we be bold in the places you're leading us to. May we be brave to take the actions that you are leading us into. And Lord Jesus, may we rejoice not only when we see your works fulfilled, but Lord, we rejoice in seeing that you've already fulfilled them, and we're just walking down the road to the place where we actually get to see it. You already had the victory laid out.
Amen.
So Lord Jesus, we rejoice before anybody else can see it, because we see what you see, and your kingdom is fulfilled, and your kingdom is expanding, and families are being renewed, and marriages are being restored, and children are being protected, and drugs are being broken, and depression is being made over, and cancer is being defeated, all by the power of your name.
Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
In your name we pray. Everybody safe?
Breathe. The presence of God. rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine.
Jesus, please speak to my heart and give me the boldness to do as you lead. I believe your word. I believe what it says about you. And I believe your promises are for me. In Jesus' name, with a big loud, everybody say amen. 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 Awesome. Awesome. Praise God. I believe it is a very, very good day. How many of you are a little bit excited today? A little stirred. Good. Praise God. Awesome. Awesome. Well, I'm a little bit excited today. It is our final week in a series called My Next Step Is. My Next Step Is. My Next Step Is. And how many of you, let me ask you this, how many of you are feeling a little greater confidence or maybe a little greater burden to make the next step that God has been leading you to move? Feeling a greater confidence, maybe a little greater burden, a little greater urging, if you will, to make the next step, the next move that God is leading you in. We have been looking at this word called courage. I'm pulling it from the word courageous. And in Joshua 1:6, where God speaks to Joshua, he says, be strong and very courageous. God does not list out and say, by the way, there's 39 kings you need to be courageous about that you're about to face. But he says, I've already given you the victory. So be strong, very courageous. And out of courageous, we pull that word courage. And courage is this. It's the ability to do something that frightens you. How many of you, I got a bottle in my pocket. I'm going to get that back to you. How many of you, a courage, the ability to do something that frightens you? Let me ask you, how many of you have something in your life you think you would enjoy, but you're too scared to do it? Skydiving. Bungee jumping. Backflips off the diving board into a pool. Racing from a policeman when he turns the lights on. Just like, I'd like to see how this would come out, but you know it's going to go bad. But just the thrill of the run for a minute. Something that frightens you. Maybe it's asking somebody out. Maybe it's saying, will you marry me? Perhaps it's speaking to someone who's close to you and saying, I just want you to know I'm sorry for the person I've been, and God has changed me, and I desire to be a better man, a better woman from this day forward, to honor God and to honor you. You know, sometimes that's a frightening step. But it's like, I would love to, but I'm scared to. As we begin today, I want to bring to your attention something very, very important. That no matter the desires you have, we have, no matter how strongly we may know that God is saying, now, next step, go. Do we realize the outcome will never actually happen until we do it? It will not happen. The proposal never made is a marriage that never happens. The invite never given is possibly the life change that never happens. Which, by the way, while I'm thinking about it, there are invite cards on the back table. We'd love for you to take some and pass them out. Seriously, it is it's life-changing conversations it will engage you with. It is easy. I do this. I say, you go to church anywhere? I need to. Not as much as I should. You know, whatever it is. I would love for you to come in. I think you would love it. I know you would love it. All right. Yeah. And then usually it's a couple of few weeks, and boom, you see them. So, but the invite never given is possibly the life change that never happens. The baptism never followed through with is the freedom experience that never happens. The forgiveness that is never given is the freedom that is never found. The submission to God's word that is... The submission to God's word is a rejecting his promise. The submission to God's word that is rejected is a promise of God's outcome that is denied. I don't know about you. I don't want God's word denied in my life. It's great to feel led. It's great to have courage. It's great to have this courage rising up. It's great to actually begin planning and talking about it. But can we be honest just a minute? If the step isn't taken, it is a life, it is a promise that God has provided us for that we have denied. If the step is not taken, it is the promise that God has provided for that we have denied. I'm just kind of building this, and then we're going to bring practicality on this for just a moment. But I believe this. I say a lot of these things, but can I tell you this also on the flip side? I believe that I'm in a church that is ready to make more bold and courageous steps than ever before. I really do. I believe you are a people that will say, that will one day look back and say, I am glad I did, and not be the people that say, I wish I had. I believe that about you. I believe I'm speaking to a people who are taking bigger steps and believing God bigger than ever before and are ready to see what God can do through you. And because I believe that about you today, I want to help you face this other side. We got any Star Wars fans in the house? I like my man Luke Skywalker, because Luke Skywalker wasn't afraid to go and face the dark side and believe that he could bring the good out of it. If you don't know that, go watch Star Wars. It's kind of a fun journey my kids got me in a few months ago. But I want to invite you in. A lot of times with God, there's this step. That a lot of times we make the step, and thinking about it, planning about it, talking about it is exciting. But then we make it, and a lot of times, can I say this, help us face the dark side of in between and help us find the victory in the dark. Because a lot of times, have you ever been there where you take a step and then you're like, well, that wasn't what I thought. Maybe it doesn't turn out the way you thought. Maybe no fireworks take off. You're like, I just can't wait till I arrive at this day. And then you get there and you build the courage. You step in there. You have the conversation. You speak the words. You do the action, whatever it is. But then it's like, what was I scared of? Nothing happens. Have you ever been there? There's a dark side sometimes. I want to take you, if I can, I'm going to take you through a little Bible quiz real quick with Matthew 4:16. Matthew 4:16 is a prophecy fulfilled from 600 years prior. Matthew 4:16 is where Jesus begins announcing that he is the Savior, the Messiah coming to earth. Matthew 4:16, there is a reference to the prophecy in Isaiah 9:2 that we'll look at later. And it says this. It says, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. That's good. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. But follow up to Matthew 5:14, and so quickly, Jesus goes from doing this to he steps into his very first sermon that is recorded in Scripture. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. It's a few pages in your Bible. It's kind of a lengthy. It's the most lengthy one you will find. And Jesus takes this and he says, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light about himself. And then he steps right into Matthew 5 and his very first sermon, he says, now I pass this baton, if you can, on to you. You are the light of the world. Like a city set on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. And then he rolls right back down. This is where courage changes. This right here is where courage changes to courageous. Because courageous is brave. It's doing something with that courage. It's not just having courage, but it's actually bravery is doing something with that courage. And he steps into this and he says in verse 16, watch this. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. The very first way Jesus began, he says, I am the light that shines into the darkness. And then he steps right around and he says, now you're the light. I shine my light so that you may glorify my Father. You may come to me and glorify my Father who's in heaven. Now, let your light shine. And he passes this baton. He passes this torch on. It is said in verse 16, though, if we back up. Look at this. It's a very key word in Matthew 4:16. Watch this. It's tricky. The people who, what? Let's say it's real. This is a big word. The people who, what? Three-letter word. Let's try it. I know when you're sitting, you're not as loud, but just try it. The people who what? Thank you. The people who sat in darkness, have seen a great light. Have you ever been in a really dark place where, and realized that in the darkness, everything moves slower? Well, you know, when you're stumbling out of your bed in the morning, if you're the kind of people, you know, you black out your windows, if you kind of had that effect going on. And what do you do in the morning? If you don't turn your lamp on, maybe because somebody else, you're trying not to wake up, and you're easing through. Y'all have that? Or maybe if you don't have a lamp right beside you, got a light switch, so you're feeling your way through. Y'all do that? You notice we move a lot slower in the dark. Let's try it. Let's just pretend. Let's pretend we turn the lights off. We're not actually going to do this. But if you would close your eyes and go with me on this. We got a little journey for a minute. And close your eyes. And if you're like me, when you close your eyes, it becomes dark. The lights are out. And if all the lights right now in this room was turned off, and let's just picture, and it's pitch black, most of you would sit there for a time, possibly. Like you're waiting for the lights to come back on. Wait till the lights come on before we move. But just imagine, let's pick in the middle of this darkness. There's some terrifying sound. I don't know what it is, but some terrifying sound. And somebody says, run! Without opening your eyes. I want you right now, with everybody that knows where an exit is, point which way you would run right now. Hold your hands. All right, now open your eyes. Look around you. Who are you going to be tripping over? It's about to be catastrophe. Even if everybody, your very first step, some of you pointed across chairs. You're not going very far. Your very first step should be out the road. You got to make a couple of corners. But if everybody's trying to make the road, we got a catastrophe again. We all know that if it's a terrifying noise, we all know we need to get out of here. We all know the general area of the exits. But we also realize there will be heads colliding. There will be tripping over chairs. There will be people stepping on each other. And so pretty quickly, would I be accurate to say this? Pretty quickly, many of us would realize, we'd learn that while I know I need out, but because of my swollen head and because of the chair I tripped over, I realize it's just painful if I just sit here in the dark. It's a lot less damaging if I just sit in the dark, even though I can't see where to go, how to go, or any help coming out of this. It's less painful if I just sit in the dark. It's better to not try anything, but just to sit. Perhaps that's maybe where some people are in here today. Perhaps it may be exactly where you are. You come to church, but your life is full of darkness. You don't know why. You don't know where you are. But it looks too painful to try and get up and leave and end up failing, because the potential of failure looks more painful than sitting. And in that very place, Matthew 4:16, Jesus spoke. Jesus shows up. Actually, he fulfilled a prophecy. And the very first place that Jesus began his introduction of himself to humanity as Savior was for those who lived, it says, who sat in darkness. Can I pull that scripture back up? Who sat in darkness. And for those who lived in a land where death cast its shadow, a light has shined. Do you know what a shadow does? A shadow tells you what's close by. A shadow tells you possibly what's approaching. And it says, where death has cast its shadow, a light has shined. Perhaps in all of history of God's reaching mankind, there is no more darker place than in Matthew 1, if we can back up. In all of history, from creation all the way forward, there's probably no greater recording of the darkness that humanity has experienced in all of our time of existence than Matthew 1. Watch with me. I'm going to read you a very, very confusing passage real quick in verse 12. I'm going to read it fast, and that way if I mispronounce things, you can just forget what I mispronounced. Matthew 1:12 says, after the Babylonian exile, Jehoiakim was the father of Shealtiel. Shealtiel was the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was the father of Abiud. Abiud was the father of Eliakim. Eliakim was the father of Azor. Verse 14, Azor was the father of Zadok. Zadok was the father of Achim. Achim was the father of Eliad. Eliad was the father of Eleazar. Eleazar was the father of Nathan. Nathan was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Let me show you why that's important. Matthew 1:12. There is a lot of history from creation to Matthew 1:12. A lot of population has increased over a few thousand years there from creation to Matthew 1:12. A lot of population increased. A lot of great times. There's been decades of victory. There's been decades of abundant living. But there's also been a lot of losing every single thing they had. By verse 12, the people lived their own way long enough and removed themselves from God's protection for so long that up until verse 13, when a man named Abiud was born. Abiud. There were prophets before Abiud. God spoke to man. There was a divine guidance, a divine provision, a divine care. Whether they chose to abide in that divine protection and care and control or not, it was there. It was on the table up to a man named Abiud. But once Abiud comes along, everything goes quiet. You can go so far as to look up any of the names after from Abiud on down. You can get your Bible. You can Google. You can do whatever you want. You can research these guys. You will find no reference to them anywhere but right here. You can find the people mentioned before them, and you can find what they did, and you can find who they were, and you can find things that happened in their history. But these is where God went silent. For the next 400 years from Abiud's birth, for the next 400 years, there was only silence between heaven and earth. And for 400 years, God, in his goodness, did not do so much as even whisper to mankind. That part where you turn over from Malachi in your Old Testament, and then you turn your Bible over, it's blank. The next page typically says New Testament. You flip it over again, it says Matthew 1. That blank in New Testament, that's 400 years right there in a couple of pages. And man had chosen this place. They had chosen this place where they landed inside. They chose this place by rejecting God's promises of guidance, by rejecting his protection, and rejecting his provision. These are all good things. And for the first time ever in history, it appeared that all hope was gone. It appeared for the first time in history that really all hope was lost. I wonder if you've ever been there. Perhaps that's a lie you hear in your head as God has burdened you with your next step. You're like, I hear this urge. I know where God is leading me. I know that it is beyond me. And I know that he is able. But at the same time, you know what? For me, can I be honest? I just feel like it's a little too late. I'm a little too hopeless. And in all honesty, it's just a little too impossible. You can see now the reason for this step. You know it's time to quit putting it off. But you also realize, you see the impossibility of God being able to do anything with you in this step. I wonder if you ever land there. I got a question for you. What do you do? What do you do when the outcome is impossible to see? When you want to believe, but also want to quit. You ever land there? God, I want to believe, but really the pressure is so much, it looks so impossible. I really just want to quit. I want to, and I'm not just saying quit everything, but just quit in this. I want to quit being burdened here. I'm just going to quit praying for that and walk away, because I find out the praying for it involves me in more desperation for it than if I could just walk away. I want to just turn and walk away. What do you do when the outcome appears impossible to see? When you want to believe, but you also want to quit. Do I have anybody like that? When perhaps you're single and you're like, you know what, I want to believe God has somebody for him, but I also want to tell you, I want to quit waiting and trying to play this God's way. I want to believe for my kids that good things are going to happen, but you know what, I really just want to quit believing by faith. I just want to try to shield them from everything and make them in this little cocoon where they're oblivious to the world. As if we could do something. I want to believe that if I let them go, that I'll be better. But, you know, I really don't want to be alone. That doesn't apply to marriages. I want to believe that God will provide for me. But you know what? I want to go out. Even if this deal's crooked, I can score a few bucks that I really need right now. What do you do when it's saying the outcome is impossible to see? And you want to believe, but also just want to quit and walk away. For the people after Zerubbabel, I like that name. It's a couple of y'all have some kids coming up, you know, Zerubbabel, that's a good name. You can change it, it's not too late. For the people after Zerubbabel in Matthew 1:13, impossible outcomes began, and impossible outcomes intensified in the years of waiting. Waiting for a promised Messiah. Impossible because it appeared God had finally quit. It appeared that they had finally, in their minds, that they had possibly pushed him for too long and too far, and he finally said, fine. Because, see, up until 200 years before this, 600 years before we read Matthew, 200 years before the silence began, there was a prophecy about a Savior who would be born, who would be named God with us, Emmanuel, who had said, a light will shine in the darkness, and where death casts its shadow, a light has shined. And all this was spoken of to come. And for 200 years, for generations, it's like, we don't see it, but we're banking on it. We don't see it, but we have hope. But whatever, because the prophets were coming, and even if they didn't want to listen to the prophet, hey, at least God is still speaking. It's not over. But when all of a sudden they go, the prophet said, what did God say? And say, he ain't say nothing. And it just goes into deathly silence for history. All of a sudden, the promise of a light will shine. Begin to wonder, will this darkness really ever end? It will continue, if we will continue to make the steps of obedience, anticipating the revealing of his promise, we will realize that God is faithful. If we'll continue. And we realize that he even uses the waiting as our teacher. I wonder, have you ever learned anything in the waiting season? Because here's what does. The wait reveals. Check me on this. This is truth or lie test right here. The waiting reveals. The waiting. Making the step. Walking in obedience. Honor of God. No matter if anyone knows or not. Doing the faithful step by step. The waiting reveals if our hope and our peace and our faith is actually in the outcome. Or if our faith, our hope, and our peace is actually in our Savior. Because when the outcome isn't coming out like we think, we lose our peace, we find out that we really consider the outcome our Savior and not our Savior as our Savior. Let's be honest. A lot of times our outcome is our Savior because this, right? If everything would just work out, everything would be better, right? Well, it would be better when really it's better because his work is already done. If I just had that, then it would finally, everything would be better. Anybody there? Yeah. And we forget that it's already better because of who we have. It's waiting is a teacher. Waiting reveals things. You know, it's the last minute funding for an adoption that we've been through that taught me more about God's goodness than the first installment ever did. It's the child that loses it in our home sometimes, and that can be different one of the different times. And the child just, and you're just going like, I want to just tie them up, take them out, and say, come back in an hour. It's just all out, loses it, and common sense is out the door, and any rational is gone. It is just absolute nuts. And it's that child that comes in 10 minutes and says, I'm sorry. I don't know why I act like that. I don't want to be that person. Forgive me. That, and you know what? That teaches me way more about God's faithfulness than the perfect days ever do. It's riding sometimes for me. It's riding on tires that show wires for months on end. Because the groceries are still having to come in the house and things are happening. And so other bills have to be paid. So we ride on the wires in faith. And it's the months of riding on the wires for showing through the tires that teaches, that shows, reveals God's provision for me way more than a new set ever does. The waiting is a teacher, isn't it? The waiting is a teacher. It's the person that serves on the dream team for the first time ever, reaching out and using what God is doing through them to impact other people's lives, that just fires me up and reveals God's faithfulness to me way more than the person who will do anything anytime. Isn't the waiting a teacher? Does this make sense? I get in a lot, huh? I want to read those names again, but starting from Abiud in verse 13. Follow with me. We're going to make sense. Beginning with Abiud. Abiud was the father of Eliakim. Eliakim was the father of Azor. Azor was the father of Zadok. Zadok was the father of Achim. Achim was the father of Eliud. Eliud was the father of Eleazar. Eleazar was the father of Mathan. Mathan was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. Mary gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Messiah. In that little passage right there, there are 10 generations. There are those in 10 generations that never, some of those people, especially at the beginning side of that, in those 10 generations, never saw the star that shined over Bethlehem. They never saw the light actually come. These people listed of a certain family line through which the Messiah was prophesied to come from the very beginning. And even though there may have been 400 years, even though there may have been 10 generations of silence, even though there may have been 10 generations of darkness, those generations of silence were not God's forgetfulness as it felt, but were actually his faithfulness to continue his work even in the dark. Because Isaiah 9:2, watch this. We're going to step back. I gave you that. The people who walk in darkness, these people aren't sitting. You can say walking at that phase. By the time he got to them, they'd done sat down. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. It will shine. Check this out. It says, for those who live, if we can just leave this right there. If those who live in a land of deep darkness, it says, a light what? A light what? If you did it the first time, I wouldn't have to do it that time. A light will, you catch that? It will shine. It's like there are no other options on the table as far as God is concerned. It does not matter the day. It does not matter the months in between. It does not matter the weeks in between. It does not matter if there's years in between. It will. It has no other option. It is commanded. It is under the authority of God. It is spoken. It is declared. It is promised. It cannot change. No matter what you do. I love how Paul tells Timothy, he says, even when we are faithless, God is faithful, for he cannot deny his word. He cannot go apart from his word. And it says a light will absolutely shine. In the silence, God was faithful to bring his promise, even though they couldn't see it. And just like he is leading you and I into a perfect plan that he has for us, God was faithfully bringing about his promise through all those generations, just step by step, generation by generation, birth by birth, marriage by marriage, child by child, grandchild by grandchild. He was doing it step by step. From the moment he said, he began counting down his clock. And he says, these are steps we got to go through. And at the end of these steps, you will see that I was faithful all in the middle. I wonder who needs a little bit of encouragement right now to realize where you are in your middle. God is faithful in the middle. You don't have to see it. You just receive it. It's His goodness. He's never failed before. He will never fail in the future. He creates new things out of us, but He never does new things. He is the same. He has proven over and over and over. He is always, always, always faithful. So you never have to ever wonder, will He ever slip up? Will He ever change His mind? And in Him, there is no shifting shadow. There is no way of change. It is just consistent by the authority of His Word. He makes it step by step. So let me ask you this. What is the next step that He is already leading you or He's led you to do? But perhaps you paused. Is there an area perhaps where it was like, dang, man, everything was going along and I felt like God was moving and I was making those steps and I was just about to. But then the situation changed, the environment changed, the climate changed, the anticipation changed a little bit, and you had a down week and just stalled right there. You ever been there just so excited but then not followed through with any area of life? What is the next step that He is leading you to do, but you pause and you stop? And perhaps you're saying the things like this. One day, perhaps trying to sound spiritual because we love to put spiritual defeat on God's victories. And perhaps sound spiritual by saying, well, when I feel like I'm a little stronger. Anybody been there? When I feel like I'm a little better prepared, I'm just not there yet. When I have some more time, when I get some things straight. And really all we are doing is rejecting the courage that God already gave us to take the next step. With every excuse, with every alibi. There is a voice in the darkness. There is a voice today in the darkness that whispers in our ears. And it tells us this. It tells us, you know what? That was just emotional. That's why it passed. That was just emotional. Don't worry about it. You're just, you know, it was the music. It was the conversation. It was a testimony. It was a story. It was, you know, you were reading your Bible. And, you know, it really wasn't anything. It was just an emotional moment you were having. It urges us to look for something. It will take the next step and says, you know what, if that's really God, then I'm going to look for some confirmation. I'm going to look for some confirmation that this will actually work out. And so we kind of counsel people. I used to kind of sometimes get in some of the services where the guy would tell people stories. And he would call people out, you know, and would read mail. And I'd always stand in the crowd and I'd say, God, if that's real, then have Him say something about me. I'm glad He didn't. Could have gotten more embarrassing than y'all's little bit of laughter. Especially in my younger years, it could have got me in severe trouble. But I'd always, if this is really you, then confirm it. I want to see it. I think sometimes it was real, sometimes it was malarkey. That's people. You got to learn to work with it. But don't throw the baby out of the bathwater over a few bad eggs. You ever been there where you ask for things perhaps and that God's leading to it and ask over and over and over, well, God, if this is really you, then, you know, have a red car drive past me at the red light when I get there. God, if this is really you, well, you know, have my wife make breakfast this morning. As soon as I'm out of bed, it's ready. You know, whatever. Think of some ridiculous things. God, if this is really you, then have somebody else tell me something. They don't know anything about this. And have them talk to me, and they have no idea they're leading me this way. You ever had those kind of conversations? Looking for confirmation. Here's a question to take very seriously, though. What if the confirmation will be found only in the fruit of our obedience? And if we leave with nothing else today, what if the confirmation, and we do have where people lay out things in the Old Testament. We had that. We have where God confirms. I believe He confirms. But sometimes when we put Him to the test, He's also saying, my test to you is just be faithful to what I've already called you to. Have I not said it, and will I not do? So what if the confirmation we're looking for will only be found as a result of our obedience, and we're sitting on disobedience waiting for a confirmation, and God is saying, when you are obedient, then you will see. When we make a step by faith, the external inconveniences are suddenly become overcome by the internal hope and the promises of God. The external inconveniences become overcome by the internal hope and the promises of God. When my family began the journey that would bring my daughter Camilla home, we had absolutely no idea what we were doing. We had no idea who she was at the time. We had no idea where she was. We had no idea how old she was. We had no idea the pain, literally, that we would have to walk through in order to find her. We had no money. We had no knowledge. We had no time to do the things that we were required to do. We were totally bankrupt in every area. We didn't have the heart, nor did we have the endurance that was required. We didn't. But we took the first step. And the light began shining in the steps that were taken. Could I get an amen, Callie? But had we sat in fear and had we kept waiting for confirmation, it's not just one person that we would not know and our family would not be blessed with, but it's four. If we would have denied one, we would have denied four. You know, the beautiful part is this, and actually, just knowing directly and knowing quite a few others indirectly, and actually there are four other stories that we directly know of because of a light shining in others' darkness when they witnessed the steps that God was carrying us through. Because God, so it's not just four anymore, there's eight. And there's more than that that we know of indirectly through the grapevine. So God took us and said, if you'll be faithful, you'd be faithful in the step and leading. We thought we were coming home with one. We've now come home with four. We start catching stories from other people. They send stuff on Facebook. They send emails. They send things. They say, hey, I've been following your story, yada, yada, yada. And God has been putting this burden on our heart. He gave us the courage to take the next step. And then they will show us pictures of their families sometimes and different things. And so what God did is God took one. He turned it into four. And he took four and he turned it into four more. God always multiplies the obedience that we do. God, it's never just one step. He's wanting us to take one step for the next four steps that he's about to open up. The confirmation is often found in the obedience. Let me ask you this as the band comes. What is your next step? We've asked this for a few weeks. What is your next step? What is it that possibly you're waiting for? What is it that are you waiting for? Maybe just a little more relief. I just need a little bit of stuff on my plate first. I need a little bit of burden removed first. Maybe we're waiting for a little more relief first from something that we are going through. A little more light on the step. But God, I really don't know how to do this. I feel this calling. I feel this leading. But I don't know how. But he's already given the why. And the why is for his works, for his glory, that people would glorify our Father in heaven. According to Jesus in Matthew 5:14, here's the deal. You are the light. He speaks it to all of mankind. He says, you are the light. He brought the light to us, and now he puts the power and the calling in our hands. It is our mantle to bear. It is our responsibility for his kingdom to expand. It is our responsibility for marriages to be rescued. It is our responsibility for people to be healed. It is our responsibility for the broken to be relieved, and whether it's financial or emotional or medical or mental or what have you. It is the church's responsibility. It is the believer's responsibility. It is the follower of Christ's responsibility to make sure that, you know what, needs are met now. That kingdom is expanding. That people are finding, you know what, I no longer have to sit in darkness because there is a light I can walk in. And that I have hope and I have reason and I have purpose because I've met a Savior who gave his life for me, publicly shamed, so that I can be publicly rescue. He says, you are the light. So shine. Imagine this. Let's think about some Old Testament people. Imagine if David would have never, ever stepped to Goliath. Imagine if Joshua would have never made the first steps with the country around the walls of Jericho. They walked around it one day, 6 days of solace. Seventh day, they walk around it seven times, I think it is. The last time they shout and the walls come crumbling down. The Bible says in Joshua 6, right before that, it says, Jericho was sealed so tight that no one could enter it and no one could get out. And he speaks to Joshua, he says, see, I have given it to you. It is secured so tight that no one can get out, no one can get in. See, I've given it to you. Says, I've given it when it's totally impossible. I've given it to you before the steps were ever taken. See, I've given it to you. But no one can get in or out. It's locked down. It is completely secure. See, I've already given the victory. That's how God speaks. Imagine if a man named Daniel would not have took the steps of rebelling against the government, and he continued to pray to his God who is faithful. Imagine if some guys named Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would not have been the only three men standing on the day when the king said, everybody bow to the idol I made. And they said, no. And they stood, and you can see it over, you could just imagine over a large field, everybody goes, vroom, and there's three people standing out of thousands. For Daniel, he would have never knew the experience of using a lion for a pillow at night. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, if they had not just taken that one step, they would not have experienced what it was like to hang out with Jesus in the fire for a night and come out untouched. For Joshua, he would have never experienced what it was like to see everybody shout and the victory come, the walls come crumbling down. David would always have the story of what he could have done and should have done and would have done if he could do it over again, if he had not taken the steps and walked out there against Goliath that day. Let me ask you this. Imagine if Peter would have never stepped on the water even though Jesus said, come. We like him for sinking. Man, I want to walk. He walked. We all know how to sink. We can accuse him of that, but who else is walking on water? He would have missed out. The stories keep going and going and going. But here's the thing. No matter the stories, here's the same common core with every first step somebody takes. Every time. And it's true today as it was then, as it will be tomorrow. Most every time, the very first step looks absolutely foolish. But the people who are called foolish with the first step, from what I can see, God does not fail. So it appears he doesn't even fail because of foolishness. What I do see is that those who may be considered foolish at the first step, they also get wrote down as warriors and victories and faithful heroes when they follow through, step by step. Don't worry about a foolish beginning because God has a victorious ending that he is playing out. Let me ask you, what is your next step? What is it that you keep coming for and you keep saying you're believing God for? And what is it that you open your Bible for more than just a religious routine? What is it that you bowed your knee at some point and said, Lord Jesus, come in my life and be my Savior? What did you do that for beyond that moment? Where is God leading you to now? What did perhaps you come here today, if I can be so transparent, what did you perhaps come here today for just because perhaps somebody asked you and invited you, they've been pleading with you, they've been nagging on you, and today you finally said, okay. I have to assume for more than just a chair, and as great as the songs are, more than just a few songs that you can sing loud and nobody judges you. At home they can hear you through the walls, but here you can do it, sing as loud as you want. And just be free. What is the next step God is leading you to? For some, can I say this? What is that he's been telling you to lay down? And we keep saying one day, but one day never comes. A man I like to listen to, Andy Stanley, says it like this. Sometimes you just got to open the cage and go in there with that 500-pound lion and face it. It's the fear. Sometimes, what is it today? This time, you know, it looks like a ferocious lion. It's fearful. But today, God just saying, you know what? Open the cage and walk in there with it. Face it. For some, it's confession. It's repentance. For some, it's surrender. Let me ask with heads bowed and eyes closed. Today, maybe baptism, it may be ministry. It may be forgiveness. It may be sharing testimony publicly out and about in society. It may be apologizing to some people when you get home and letting them know you're moving in a new direction. But perhaps today it's salvation and the Lord has called you and you said, "What? Wait, these people speak of a God who came to people in the position I am. I feel like I've been in the dark for a while. And my life has been empty for a while. And I've known this for a while. And I've tried to find fix in different people and in different places. And I keep coming up empty every time I wake up. I'm waking to the same person. But today I'm learning. You know what? There's a place that gathers that says there is a Jesus who did not just die for me, but he died to rescue me. and to pull me out of this darkness, that I can actually walk in a light and I can see what's coming and I can see where I'm going and I can trust that He is providing the provision and the protection and the guidance every step of the way, that there is a fulfillment in this relationship with Jesus. Perhaps today is the day where you say, you know what, I am tired of being the person in darkness. The light is shining and today I'm going to give my life to Jesus Christ. Today I want to ask Him to be my Savior, my Lord. If that's you from right where you are with head bowed and eyes closed, would you just raise your hand right there? I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. We're not going to make a spectacle. I just want to reach out to you and let you know, you know what? God knows right where you are. And you're not here by random chance. That's why you're here. Lord Jesus, I thank You for the good and the faithful work You're doing through so many here today. Lord Jesus, may we grow into the perfect image that You desire, that You have guarded and protected us for, that You have rescued us to live into Your glory. May we become the people that are completely free, that addictions are no more, for bitterness is no more, God. May we grow into the people that we see that You have provided every healing. May it happen today for anyone who is sick in here. May healing be happening right now in Jesus' name. And Lord Jesus, may this be the most reckless abandon of worship time here on the close of this service that anyone in here has ever experienced. Truly experiencing heaven on earth. Just releasing ourselves and allowing You to fill us up with Your goodness. If you would love to be a part of it, would you please stand right where you are? We're going to honor the Lord. We're going to lift Him up. We're going to worship Him. And we're going to turn our hands and our hearts toward heaven, incline our heart toward Him. Lord Jesus, give me boldness from this day forward. Take hold of that bravery that He's already given you.